Good morning, church. Happy New Year. This is a season of new beginnings, milestones, reestablishing who we are, what we're here for, and a devotional that I have that someone gave to me that I like to use a lot says, all of these are worthy goals, those things that we set as new goals for the year, but for the Christian, they should all flow from putting Christ first. You lose weight to honor God who dwells in the temple of your body. You read more to nourish your mind. You tame your tongue to be a better witness. You get out of debt so you can be free to invest in the kingdom. You volunteer because you want to show people the love of Christ. Reminds me of a verse from Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you as well. Someone might even write a song about that someday. Let's invite the Holy Spirit this morning to renew us, to refresh us, to establish us new as his people this morning. God, we thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to gather as a people of God, to be discipled by your Holy Spirit and one another, to grow in the grace and the knowledge of you, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I pray that you would bless this gathering, those who are able to be with us this morning and those who are unable to be with us, that you would do your work among your people. In your holy and precious name, Jesus, amen. And before we move on from our announcements, I want to mention that we have 4 live poinsettias sitting out in the entrance that were donated from Mendota Mental Health. And I want you, anyone who would like to have one of those, are welcome to take one. With that, I invite you to stand as we worship together. Sharing the word from John 1. In the beginning was the Word. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us.
We have seen his glory, the glory of the one
who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Let's pray together. Jesus, when we believe you, we believe not only in you, but in the one who sent you. When we see you, we too see the Father. You have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in you should stay in the darkness. Jesus, you are the light of the world. Whoever follows you will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Let's sing together number 223, verses 1 and 3. Break forth, O beauteous heavenly light. Thank you.
And so on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after supper, he took the cup and blessed it, saying, "This is the new cup in my blood, the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, for whenever you eat the bread or you drink the cup, you proclaim my death until I return." So awesome and glorious God, we give you thanks for these signs of your holy covenant with us, the body and the blood of Jesus Christ shed for us. May we take them, may we be renewed, may we receive them with gratitude and thanksgiving in our hearts. To you be the glory. Amen.
Good morning. Happy New Year. It is a new day, a new year, new beginnings, a year of discovery as we seek, even I think about this time as we've been doing so much work on thinking about what is our future here, knowing God's will and regarding BHBUMC, and it's also today is the day of Epiphany. And, you know, the definition of the word, insight, inspiration, a realization, a vision, an illuminating discovery. And also, it's a custom at this time of the year that is the manifestation of Christ to the Gentiles that was represented by the Magi, which is traditionally celebrated on January 6th, which is still coming up in the church year. And it is the day when the wise men bring the baby Jesus the gifts, and they came to worship him. And there are still a lot of cultures that celebrate Epiphany more than they celebrate Christmas. So, you know, we do Christmas and the gifts, and yet Epiphany is when the wise men came, and so that's their big celebration day, is January 6th. Gift giving. We'll get to that in a minute. We celebrated Christmas Eve with the kids. You know, they did the Christmas program here that night. We celebrated the greatest gift that ever was given to us, Jesus, the Savior born for all mankind, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and that was what the kids did with their program. They told the story of that, the humble birth in the manger, the cow shed, and a manger bed. They were talking about this king coming, and they were expecting this royal, you know, procession and all these kingly things, and it was not. We all know that story. It was very humble. And yet the angels declared this baby that he was the Christ, the Messiah. And the shepherds, they went, they saw for themselves just what the angels had told them, and they spread the news of this holy birth. So we're going to read Matthew's gospel. Well, first we're going to read, this portion about the Magi. We don't have that narrative in the Gospel of Luke, where we read all about, you know, the Christmas story that we put on, you know, the pageant. So this is from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will be shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them exactly the time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. So again, in Matthew's narrative, it leads up to the story of Joseph and the dream, and that they went to Bethlehem and she gave birth to a son, Jesus. And then they pick up to where the Magi come. So the three wise men, we call them the three wise men, the Magi, they came from the east. So they were astrologers, they were astronomers, they looked to the heavens, they studied the stars, they studied signs, and I'm just guessing at this, as far as this is how I picture it, that, you know, they all of a sudden see something in the heavenlies that is unusual, and they're looking at their books of knowledge, and they know that that star represents a king, that was born. And so right away, these are Gentiles, and they go and they follow the star because they want to go. Their purpose was to go and worship this new king. So they brought gifts, and they go to Jerusalem, figuring, okay, well, where's this king that was born? And, of course, who's king? Herod's king. And these people come and are talking about a new king. That's a little upsetting to Herod. He's not very happy about that. And so he's a little bit, okay, got to figure this out. So he's asking the teachers of the law, does it say? Anyway, what is this about? You know, if this is king of the Jews, what is this about? And they said, yep, this is where he's supposed to be born. And so now Herod's thinking, he's devising a plan. He says, okay, you go and you find him, and then you come back and tell me all about it. So the wise men go, they keep following the star, and it says they come to the place where the child was with his mother. So most of your nativities, you will see that the wise men come in on the night of baby Jesus' birth. Contrary to that, it probably was not that way, that the wise men came afterwards. They came to the place where the child was with his mother, in a house. It says to the house. And so we're thinking that at that time, they were in Bethlehem in a different dwelling. They were not in the manger at that time. That the wise men came later. And so you'll have to read it for yourself. I mean, if we look at it that way, that it was after that. So picture Bethlehem a little quieter maybe than that it had been on the night that he was born. And these people from the east come with their packs and their animals, probably traveling that great distance, and they stop where the star had led them to this place. And I want to read it correctly. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary. And what did they do? They bowed down and worshiped him. They knew this child was the king. So they bowed down and worshiped him. They opened their treasures and they presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Three gifts. Gold. One commentary mentions this, that gold was given to kings to recognize their lordship and authority. By giving gold to Jesus, the wise men affirmed that he was indeed the King of Kings. Frankincense is an incense used only in worship to God. The wise men presented it to Jesus and fell down and worshiped him. That action, along with the gift, proclaimed this child's deity, that Jesus, this child, was indeed the Son of God, the Messiah. And myrrh was an aromatic spice, a bitter perfume. In fact, I think that's in one of the verses of the song, a bitter perfume, was used to embalm and prepare a body for burial. So those three gifts, you think about those three gifts, and do you wonder what Mary and Joseph thought about those gifts? They weren't baby booties and blankets and diapers. It was gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And what good were those gifts to this little family? I'm going to keep reading the rest of this story because here's the dark part of this story. Starting in verse 13. Because remember, having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, the Magi returned back to their country by a different route. So they knew that something was not quite right. So when they had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up," he said. "Take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him." So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod. So I don't know how long that was exactly. Maybe somebody knows. But I'm assuming for a time. "And so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, 'Out of Egypt I called my son.' When Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious, and he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled. 'A voice is heard in Ramah, weeping in great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because they are no more.'" So Herod was so upset that there was this upstart king that would threaten his throne, and the Magi outsmarted him. He was in a rage. He said, "Go kill all the kids under age 2. Can you imagine? You just can't imagine that. What was happening in those towns? There was no rhyme or reason for it. It was just pure anger against a new king. But the angel saved Mary and Joseph and that baby because he had a purpose to fulfill. And so they escaped to Egypt. And the hard part is that there was all these other little innocent boys that were killed during that time because of this anger that Herod had. But that's part of the story. That's part of the story. So after Herod died, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who were trying to take the child's life are dead." So he got up, took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel. But when he, But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning in Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Having been warned again in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee, and he went and lived in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled what was said through the prophets, "He will be called a Nazarene." So there was all these prophecies woven through the Old Testament scriptures that talk about a virgin being born, that he would be called out of Egypt, he would be a Nazarene. All these fulfillments in Jesus. So I was thinking again about those gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. What good were they? Well, if this little family, I'm assuming they were not well-to-do family, they had gold in their pockets now. They had to escape to a foreign country, in a sense, to them, with nothing more than what they had, and they didn't know how long they were going to stay there. This is just my guessing. They had some means through that gift of gold. Frankincense, what good would frankincense have? It's an incense. It's part of their worship. And my thinking is maybe they used it in their private time of worship because they would have still, even being in Egypt, they would have followed the traditions of the law. They would have still worshiped their God in a foreign land. And they had that beautiful gift of frankincense, maybe to burn in their times of worship. And the myrrh, I theory that Mary probably saved that myrrh, which is probably very expensive and a rare gift, knowing that it would be used someday for her son. And it did come to be fulfilled. She probably did use that when her son died and was buried, and that she had that gift of myrrh. So what does this have to do with us? What's the lesson of the Magi? Well, first of all, they saw a divine sign, and they went seeking. They didn't just say, "Oh, that's cool." They wondered about it, and they thought, "Okay, this is a sign. We're going to go. We're going to seek." You see that little decal, "Wise men still seek him." We're still seeking him. And they knew whom they were seeking. They were seeking a king. It wasn't like it was a question. They knew that star probably meant a new king was born. So they knew what they were seeking. And they knew the purpose of their search was to worship the king. That's why they went. We are here to worship the king. And then they gave gifts in honor of the one that they found. So we're going to go to a few scriptures. So likewise, let's see what it says about gold. So get out your Bibles because you're going to have to help me here. Somebody look up Psalm 19, verses 7 through 11. And then I want somebody to look up 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 and on. And then somebody look up Philippians 3:10. And when you have the Psalm 19, seven through 11. And then 2 Corinthians 2, verse 14, and I'm not sure how far on. And then Philippians 3:10. Who has Psalm? Joe, you want to read 7 through 11? Precepts and the ordinance are more precious than gold. And when I think about they're more precious than gold and the precepts of the Lord and that Jesus is the Word and that connection between Jesus and the Word and the law, and it's so precious. It's even more precious than gold that we have that gift in Christ that's even more precious than a precious metal like that, and that we seek him even more than we seek gold. But it's just that it's such a precious thing, and Jesus is that greatest gift in that as well. 2 Corinthians chapter 2. Who has that? Does anybody got that? Hang on, because it's different in mine. Chapter 2, hang on, verses 14, through 17. You want to read that, John?
Let's see. You said 14?
Yes. And the key verse there is to, we are to God the aroma of Christ, like that frankincense, that incense that is burned in worship, that pleasing aroma, that act of worship. We are to God the aroma of Christ. Christ, that beautiful aroma. To some it is life, to some it is death, to those hearers, depending on how they receive it. But we are to be like that aroma, that like that frankincense, that worshiping incense. Yeah. Like they did in the temple, they burned incense in worship. We're to be that aroma of Christ. Okay, this the last verse, Philippians 3:10. Who has that one? Anyone? Colossians. Kendall, you have it? All right.
I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings in sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection of the dead.
Okay. Again, that myrrh is representing that sharing in Christ's sufferings. That in his death, there was that myrrh that was used in preparation for his death. And glory be to God, resurrection, right? And so here again, this says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death. And so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. So again, that myrrh, that idea of we share in Christ's sufferings because we're also sharing in his resurrection power. I found a quote from Pope Francis. Are they all Pope Francis? No. I don't know. Anyway, it is not enough to know where Jesus was born, as the scribes did, if we do not go there. It is not enough to know that Jesus was born like Herod if we do not encounter him. When his place becomes our place, when his time becomes our time, when his person becomes our life, then the prophecies come to fulfillment in us. Then Jesus is born within us. He becomes the living God for me. Today we are asked to imitate the Magi. They do not debate, they set out. They do not stop to look, but enter the house of Jesus. They do not put themselves at the center, but bow down before the one who is the center. So those are our lessons of the Magi and the gifts. And just another note, yesterday as I was traveling home, all Christmas I have not heard my favorite Christmas song on the radio. And it's an old one. It's the Little Drummer Boy. It's the old, old version of the Little Drummer Boy, of the beautiful choir, the women singing. I don't even know who it is. But it came on the radio as I was coming home. And I'm telling you, it was a gift. Because I hadn't heard it all Christmas. And I love that song. It just takes me right back to when I was a little girl, sitting in the den in our house with the Christmas tree that had blue lights. It had blue satin balls and silver garland and a silver topper. And it sat in the corner of the living room, and I could see it from where I sat. And I would have the record player going, you know, the big record player, and it would drop down, and that record would come on, and I would just sit there, and I would just listen. And I would sing that song. And it just takes me right back to that place of home and comfort. And being loved, and it was Christmas. That was Christmas. That's what that felt like to me. And God just dropped that little gift in the car with me the other day, and it was so precious. And the words to that, you can fill in the pa-rum-pa-pum-pums, but come, they told me, a newborn king to see, our finest gifts we bring to lay before the king. so to honor him when we come. Little baby, I am a poor boy too. I have no gift to bring that's fit to give our king. Shall I play for you on my drum? Mary nodded. The ox and lamb kept time. I played my drum for him. I played my best for him. Then he smiled at me and my drum. And I don't know why those lyrics, as a kid, just got to me. And I think it was that last verse. What do I have to give him? I just have my little drum. Okay, I'm just going to give that. And Mary smiled at him when he played his drum. So I ask you, what is your drum? What gift will you bring to the Christ child? Of course, he wants our hearts. He wants our whole life. But what are those things that you say, I have nothing to give him? You do. You have a gift to give him. And when you do give that, he just smiles. He just smiles. Amen. So, Father, we're just thanking you for your blessedness of gift giving, that you have sent your Son to be the greatest gift. And that when we receive that gift to ourselves, all heaven rejoices. And when we offer ourselves to you, our gifts, our talents, our means, Lord, you bless them and you are so pleased by the simple gift because it's given with love and gratitude. Thank you, Lord, for your I just don't even know what to say. Your goodness, your love, your kindness. Thank you, Father, for your Son, the greatest gift ever. Jesus. Amen.
It's amazing how God touches our hearts and brings to mind those things where he has touched us in the past and renews and refreshes those things. As Karen was talking about the little drummer, I know that that's her favorite song, and it has been as long as I've known her, her Christmas song. And the other day we got a video from our son, so little Reuben, guess what Christmas gift he got? And here he is plunking away on the drums, and I think that maybe that was another added gift. And so we give God credit and praise for that. And it brings me back to that verse which we started with, Matthew 6:33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you as well.
Lord, send your spirit in this place.
God, it is in humility and gratitude and thanksgiving that we come seeking you. We exalt you as the sovereign over all of the universe. We exalt you as the lover of our souls, the one who was willing to take our burden, to take our sins, that we might be forgiven and reconciled to our God. Thank you for abiding in our hearts, your spirit that is awakened through faith. Jesus, we pray for one another. We pray for those who are dealing with illnesses. We're praying for those who are dealing with the loss of life and loved ones in their families. We're praying for those who celebrate. We rejoice with those who rejoice, and we grieve with those who grieve and weep. Thank you for those life stages of retirement. Thank you, Lord, for calling us to something new as your church, as your body. And we pray for your continued guidance and leading. In all these things, we seek you first, and your kingdom, and your life, and your love, and your righteousness, that they might be ours through faith in you. And we pray to you, Father, that prayer that Jesus, you taught your disciples so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, your challenge for the day is to sing this tune, to sing this song to the tune of Away in a Manger. I know you can do it. Would you please stand as we sing together?
I invite you to receive God's blessing. May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. May God's peace.